curriculum or the way that they want to deliver the lesson, then it really isn't restricted to the grade level. So for example, if a teacher of third grade wanted to gather some input from students in her classroom in a protective manner, she could do that with her students in third grade. I'm not sure if younger than third grade would be, you know, the kids would be able to express themselves in, you know, typing the Padlet, the answers in the Padlet, but it could be done with any grade level in that respect.
Yeah, you kind of, you're leading into my next question quick.
Okay,
well,
you're setting me up.
Because you're talking about filters, you know, for the mind is a filter, you know, and I'm thinking about that now the students, they have more information during a typical conversation that they now have to filter through. And it can also be a distraction. And I think there's a learning process there. That I'm not just engaged in a conversation, you're talking, I can handle that. But now I've got all this information in front of me. How do I sift through that? How do I filter that out? How do I keep from being distracted? And while you're talking as the teacher, I'm scrolling up and I'm reading all this stuff, not paying attention to you. So those kinds of issues are things that I would think students would have to learn over time as they mature.
I think that also goes with the personalized learning. So when the teacher's instructing, I'm sure she's not, you know, throwing all the information at them at once. It's a very strategic way of presenting that information and grouping the kids and having them work collaboratively, either face-to-face or digitally. You know, it's the way that you prepare that lesson so that it can be most optimal for the student.
So is there a grade level strategy? You folks obviously know the students are this age to be able to handle this, so we have to bring them along so that by the time they reach sixth grade or whatever, they're able to handle this better.
I'm not sure if we have grade.
Yeah, I mean, along those lines, we still have to revert back to the students. Yeah. The students to tell us what's the appropriate rigor. So again, everything that we start, the conversation goes back to the teacher planning based on the Common Core standards. So what should a third grader be able to do as opposed to a sixth grader? And then finding the right tool to get the student to be engaged. So again, maybe look at the standard. What are you comparing and contrasting? Are you looking at primary documents, secondary documents? Maybe comparing a video and a text? So again, the teacher needs to look at that standard first and design a lesson and then pick the appropriate tool so they can filter out the distractions or things like that. So we always go back to the standard, a great lesson plan, and then find the right tool. So we always start with the standard. Now that'll give us the appropriate rigor, the difference between third grade and sixth grade. That makes sense. Okay.
I just have one more. Thank you so much for your presentation this evening. You did a great job. I like what I'm hearing regarding the technology. But as the video kind of explained, one of the people's biggest fear is public speaking. People fear public speaking in front of a crowd more than they fear death. Right? That's just the way it goes. So how do we effectively? We touched on it a little bit, but how do we effectively use the technology so that we can, our children can express their thoughts, put them down when they might not want to, but then we keep them, we don't let them hide behind the technology. Because as they grow and as they go into college and as they go into getting to career readiness, you know, it is going to be how do they communicate, do they effectively communicate orally, do they effectively communicate written, you know. So how do we ensure that they're not hiding behind the technology? I mean, we have that one-on-one after the technology's over and we close the Chromebook and we can discuss it, but we still might not be engaging that child there that's kind of reluctant to raise their hand. How do we help them grow out of that and effectively communicate?
I'll take it. I can speak to a couple of examples. So one of the nice things about technology is it provides students the
just want to reiterate, Ms. Santa had two valid, really valid points there. So why are people afraid to speak in public? Usually they're not comfortable, right? They don't have the opportunity. So as Ms. Santa said, number one is, you know, educators, we have to provide students with opportunities to speak in public. And I don't think that historically we've done a good job. So when you're called on the carpet to actually give a speech, it's probably the first time that you've done it. And, you know, it's part of your senior presentation. We know what that looks like, right? And we're getting better. And then the other one is about the feedback. So we have to make sure as students receive descriptive feedback so that they are comfortable when they have that opportunity to speak. So it's a lot of times a practice, but it's a comfort level. So when we talk about in this district that students should know the learning target, they should know what it means to have speak publicly, they should get feedback on it, whether it's a model of it's strong or weak, and get using that descriptive feedback from a teacher to improve their communication skills so that they can do it comfortably. So again, I think Ms. Santa highlighted two things. We're using technologies to provide more opportunities for students for public speaking, and then also to give descriptive feedback so that the students are comfortable. So again, that personalized learning, personalized feedback, so that students are more comfortable in a real world setting. So hopefully that answers your question, but we'll move into it. But it is the opportunities to practice.
I just wanted to make a final comment. Each one of us here has our concerns and our likes and our dislikes about technology, and but the core part of all of this, and it's come up tangentially but not as one, and that is the teacher. And I think as long as we have, and we do have, good teachers, all of this will be used appropriately so that all children can learn. And some of them will need more help with this than others, but in the end, it's the teacher who works with the student so that they can speak in front of a group, so that they can listen appropriately, so that they can organize their thoughts. So while I said to Mr. Driscoll that we could agree to disagree, in the whole scope of things, it is the teacher who gets that done, and I appreciate that.
I just want to add one quick thing to that, is that I agree, and I think that we maybe we just need to keep remembering to look at this digital learning as not something that's replacing the teacher in the classroom. So when we talk about, like, you know, how will they hide behind the computer and not be, the teacher is doing other things in that classroom to, you know, like the debating that I mentioned earlier. And hopefully more and more public speaking, because I know we talk about that as a skill our kids need to learn, but that digital learning is an enhancement to that. It's not taking over the classroom.
I'm sorry. But I think, and it's, again, it's not a question, but I think it's the concept that crystallized in my mind as I heard Mrs. McBride and Mrs. Schofield, just make the comments that they made, is that it seems as though the approach to this, and maybe that the appropriate focus as we continue to do these steps for continuous improvement and addressing the challenges of digital learning, is to ensure that we're using these tools to do things that we otherwise could not do, not just to use them instead of what we're doing. And that's where I think the teachers being appropriately trained and ultimately experienced in using these tools is the biggest key, because it's very easy to use technology as a crutch, and it doesn't enhance learning unless we're using it to do things that heretofore were impossible, like engaging with an explorer in Antarctica or with an expert in some area of history in California that otherwise the students wouldn't be able to use. So I think that we're asking all the right questions from what I can hear, and and I encourage and applaud you for asking those questions. I encourage you to stay focused on them as we go forward.
Thank you, guys. So just going to wrap up really quickly with just a couple of next steps that we're taking as a district, and a lot of it actually does go back to the comments you just made about how do we not just use this as a substitution for existing practices, but as a way to transform teaching and learning as we know it in the way that we defined it in that personalized learning framework. So this slide is really just how do we take where a lot of people's entry point with this, which is using technology for skill practice, kind of even going back to like math classes, but it's just like little games where you like use some math or zombie or something. And skill practice, well, really is that, how much is that going to be enhancing? So we want to get to the point where we have a shared vision of what effective personalized learning is and what it looks like in practice, specifically here in our district with our kids. So one of the things that we're going to try to do is those teacher leaders in this area that are comfortable with technology and that are using it to transform instruction, that we can put them in a position where they can have coaching opportunities, that they can create blogs and videos and share their classroom experience with people across the district, the things that we know are working that are personalized instruction. We're also trying to put them in positions where they can present at regional conferences, just like you said, we had teachers presenting at LearnLaunch. We want to put them in a position where they can expand their networks outside of our school with other networks of teacher leaders, and you can collaborate with them and share their skills. And then also sharing at district professional development. If you guys were familiar with our last PE day, we actually had a teacher-run digital learning day where they had, I think there were over 50 different sessions that teachers could choose from. Most of them were run by educators in Bristol Moore and in Middletown. So empowering them to share what they see working in the district with other educators. It's just a picture of one of our digital learning coaches leading a session during that professional learning day. And Diane, do you want to wrap up this?
Well, I think this slide, Mrs. McBride and Mrs. Schofield kind of summed it up. So at the end of the day, it's always, and you heard me say this over and over again, students, we always think about students first. Educators, the adults are our greatest resource, so we, even when we talk about digital learning, it is about great teaching and learning. It's about that amplification. Technology is not to replace teachers, but you know, educators must be at the root of great teaching and learning. If you saw in the previous slide, we're providing opportunities for our teachers to learn and grow together and learn best practice of, and also what's not working. So again, students first, educators are our greatest resource and continuous improvement. And we're asking the right questions, so I think Mr. Ramos, acknowledging that we are asking the right questions and moving in the right direction, and I appreciate the school committee's interactions tonight and how it felt to be a student, then also see how technology can enhance the teachers' questions around formative assessments and give more descriptive feedback back to the teachers. So we wanted you to experience a little bit tonight, catch you up on our vision and our progress, and talk about scaling up. So thank you for your attention tonight.
One quick comment before I say thank you so much. I wonder if it would be interesting to have a professional digital learning day with students and teachers. Would that be interesting? I don't know. I just thought, okay, so I'm just going to throw that out. Something that popped into my head.
You don't have to.
And thank you so much, Tom and Rose and Kate. Really appreciate you being here. For all your hard work, thank you. Yes, and Phil would like to say something.
I just want to add one final comment. Yeah. Jeff, final comment. First of all, like it is that you don't have autocorrect, it's pretty good, you know. But really, you know, I'm not much of a technology guy. I think this is terrific because, you know, I've had to deal with alpha figures all my life. All through school, the Jeremy Knight says, I'm not an alpha figure. You know, this is an equalizer. I'm in the classroom, I don't have to worry about the alpha figures out there dominating the show. This equalizes it for me, you know? But the problem is now, once this lid comes down, those alpha figures are still there. That's what they're going to do. So this does a pretty good job, but it's going to solve the whole problem, because I still have to deal personally with those folks out there.
But you learned something in the process.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so moving on, it looks like our next order of business is to go into an executive session. So we will do that, and then we will come back after that. Oh, and I need a motion for that, please.
I move that we go to executive session.
Pursuant to open meeting law.
Pursuant to open meeting law 42-46-5A1 for the following personnel recommendations, number S2018-09.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.